Hello everybody, welcome. This talk will be kind of different than the talks before. It will be more a technical talk that is more aimed at developers that try to use the emerging web of data. So the talk will be separated into three parts. First, I will again give a quick overview about the areas of linked data adoption so that you know what kind of data is out there and that can be used by applications. And then the actual main topic of the talk, what are currently the challenges of consuming linked data and what tools for developers are around that can be used to address these challenges, integrate data from large amounts of data sources and build applications on top. If I have time, I will also touch a third topic, which is about splitting the data integration effort. Interesting thing about linked data is that the linked data architecture can not only be used to share the actual data on the web, but it can also be used to share integration knowledge. So this database uses this database uses another schema. How do I map between the schemata? This information can also be published as linked data on the web, and therefore different people can contribute their knowledge on how to integrate data, publish this knowledge on the web, which then can be used by other applications. This is something that I think is very interesting and also separates linked data from other data integration approaches. Before I start with the web of data, I kind of repeat the motivation of linked data, because today in many talks I heard this, yes, we have this cool data source under an open license, and then we have some API, and the next person has some other API. So general problem that linked data tries to address is that there are so many different ways to expose open license data on the web. So basically, there are still walled gardens because of different formats are used, because of different technologies used for the data access. And this is exactly what the linked data, how Tim Berners-Lee has coined it, tries to address. As with the classic web, there's an idea that as many data sources as possible agree on a common set of standards for exposing their data, and there's also, as on the classic web, the idea that data sources set links pointing at other data sources. This is also something that, as we see in the wild, that many people publish their data as linked data, following the linked data best practices, but then actually don't go through the effort of setting links pointing at other data sources, which is kind of not what linked data is about, because the idea of linked data is really that you have the links connecting the data sources so that all data that is published as linked data on the web becomes part of a one single global data space that can then be used by applications. So what are the properties of this data space? Yeah, a simple set of standards already sets this. Entities are connected by links. Setting links is effort. I will also talk about tools that can be used to set these links. But links are also essential, because links, like different from classical web API approaches, where I, as an application developer, need to know all data sources against which I want to write my application. I need to know their proprietary interface, programmer against these interfaces. My application can't take advantage of new data sources that become available on the web. About the same topic, because for each new data source, I also need to read the API documentation. I need to extend my code so that this data source is also used. And this is kind of what should be addressed by the links between the data sources, because the links allow generic applications to navigate between data sources, and the links allow applications to discover new data sources that might contain interesting data for them at runtime. So it's kind of a sense why it's called linked data, this discovery aspect that's not present in other technologies like classic web APIs. So again, deployment of linked data, the technologies are getting adopted. There's kind of 200-300% growth every year. The number of triples, which is kind of the smallest information unit in the linked data universe, as of 2010 is estimated at 26 billion triples, so the data space is rather big. I say estimated because the estimates are based only on the data sets that are entered as SQL. So many people who publish linked data on the web register their data sets in SQL. There's a group on SQL, the LotCloud group, so all data sets that are entered into SQL and registered there, after some checking, end up in this linked data diagram that I will show on the next next slide. So the numbers split up by domain. We have heard a lot about government data, so increasing amount of e-government data is available. Life sciences, lots of life science data, lots of geographic data. A domain where the adoption currently explodes are libraries. So more and more libraries are starting to publish their catalogs as linked data and also interlink these catalogs to taxonomies, to specific norm daten, which I think is a rather interesting development. Yes, the cloud is well known. Yeah, it's a bit outdated. If you would draw it now again, I guess this e-government region would be much larger, and also the libraries area would be much larger. So what applications do people build on this data space? There are simple linked data browsers, there are linked data mashups, and there are linked data search engines. What I personally think are the most interesting applications are the search engines, because the search engines really use the links to crawl the complete data space. So they basically make a local copy of the complete data space of all data that's out there, and then try to answer queries over this data. So here one example of such a search engine, Falcon S, implemented by a research group in China. We search for Chicago, and the search engine finds 63,000 records in different databases that have some relation to Chicago. Another example here, Vizinav. Interesting thing about this search engine, it really allows people to express complex queries. So here we see, can't understand it, but the query is, give me the weblogs of people that are known by Tim Berners-Lee. So it's a complex query that clearly can't be answered using a normal search engine like Google today. So what I think the promise of the whole linked data and thing is that we are getting able to answer complex queries over all data that's published on the web as linked data. And the difference to it's all data, not only data from 5 data sources against which I implemented my mashup. So this thing is interesting. Another interesting linked data search engine is Sigma, which really tries to integrate the data. So here we see 20 different data sources that contain information about me. And here we see a kind of integrated display of the information from all these sources. So this engine goes one step further and tries to address the identity resolution problem and the data integration problem. Which brings me to the actual topic of the talk, how to consume linked data. There's a general problem, openness comes at a cost. So we built this open data space where everybody can publish and where everybody can use his own terms and where there are loose connections by links. This is great. This data space grows, but actually this data space is a bit like the Wild Wild West. Everybody puts data at different quality levels in there. Not everybody, but many people use their own schemata, their own vocabularies to publish data in this data space. Applications actually want something completely different. If I'm a web designer, I designed a nice user interface, then I expect a book to be described by 5 properties. title, publishing house, author, something. If I write an application that should do some calculations on budget data from different countries, I also expect all budget data from all different countries to have the same schema. Otherwise, I can't do my smart data mining on top of the data. So there, if you put the challenges into words, like the challenges are that to a certain extent, different data sources use different vocabularies to represent stuff. Also, identifier problem, the same real world entity like Berlin or like me is identified with lots of different URIs and different data sources. And of course, the quality of the data that is published varies widely. Data is inconsistent, people have different views about things, and yeah, data is often not maintained, it's getting outdated. So the things a linked data application actually needs to deal with are vocabulary mapping, try to translate data into the application-specific target schemata, identity resolution, find out which records in the thousands of databases talk about the same thing, and do some quality assessment, try to figure out which data from the different data sources the application likes to trust and which it prefers to consider as wrong or outdated. So if you look at the general architecture of most linked data applications, we see that the tricky part is this layer. So here we have the publication layer. There's fast progress in this layer, all the tools are there, there are more and more data sources, all the published data becomes part of the web of linked data, one global graph that spans data sources, and then here I have my application code, my books application or my budget application that expects data in a specific format. So what do we need to do in between? We somehow need software to access the web of data, crawl the data. We need software to normalize the different vocabularies people are using. We need to find out what different URIs identify the same thing, and we need to do some quality evaluation. And the message of my talk for developers is actually, yes, we need to do all the stuff, but there are now open source software components for all these tasks that can readily be used. So I'm basically just listing the things, can't go into the details because of time restrictions. There's LD Spider, which is the flexible open source linked data crawler, which you can use to crawl data from this data space. It crawls RDFA as well as RDF XML and follows links between data sources, saves you the data either as files or puts the data into the triple store of your choice. There's one tool, R2R, which is a framework for translating data between different vocabularies. In the Semantic Web community, there was also OWL, which allows you to express some data translation knowledge, but the idea here with R2R was to have a language that allows you to express all the sophisticated data translation things that you need in real-world settings, like structural transformations or property-value transformation. One data source uses Fahrenheit, the other uses Celsius. So you need a function which recalculates the values. All this can be expressed using the R2R framework. For identity resolution, there is Silk Server, a tool that looks at the data and applies different identity resolution heuristics to find URIs in different data sources that identify the same object. How does it do it? It basically compares, basically you provide the tool with a heuristic saying in order to compare cities, you should look at the names if they are rather similar and the geo-coordinates are rather similar, and if the two cities are in the same country, then conclude that these two records in the two different databases are about actually the same city, Berlin. This tool is available. since yesterday, another tool that basically combines the functionality of the other two has been released. So basically, linked data integration framework, which allows you to normalize vocabulary and do this identity resolution thing. Currently, there's only an in-memory implementation. Within the next 1 or 2 months, there will be a Hadoop-based implementation, which then will scale to the large amounts of data that you actually want to integrate. So if the web of data is 26 billion triples big, you need tools that are able to scale to this size, go through all the data and try to figure out for you which data is about people, which data is about books. So this is, I think, an interesting tool. There are some other tasks that linked data applications need to perform. Most important task is provenance tracking. So basically, you like to remember where you actually, in which data set you found actually which fact. Since several years, there's an extension to the RDF data model called RDF Around, which can be used exactly for this. So basically, it allows you to, in your local representation of the data, put triples from different sources into specific graphs, and then store provenance information saying, I found this graph in this source and I crawled it 2 weeks ago, and the other graph I crawled 1 week ago. There are also different vocabularies around for representing this provenance information. There's currently a provenance working group. It was an XG, but now it's a working group which also tries to define a standard vocabulary for representing such provenance information. A part that's still tricky and there are not too many good tools around for the developer is the information quality assessment part. So trying to filter out data that is spam or that is outdated based on provenance information or other types of quality indicators. There's a wide range of domain-specific heuristics that you actually would like to apply to do this type of quality assessment, to filter data or even to fuse data. So heuristic is also, I have 30 data sources that give me a population count of Berlin. I use some quality assessment heuristic to rank them and then trust the data source, take the value from the data source that I trust most. So there are some approaches. The Weakvark framework is one example software toolkit. It's now also a bit outdated, which kind of addresses these challenges. But there's lots of room for developments or even research in this data quality assessment area. So mid-summary, the tools are all there. You can use them. So hands-on, if you want to play around with linked data from the web, get some linked data crawler, for instance, LDSpider, crawl some data from the web, store it together with provenance information in some RDF store. There are also various RDF stores around that currently also scale to decent amounts of RDF data, meaning 2-3 billion triples on a single machine with normal memory. As decision help, there's a Berlin Sparkle benchmark, which compares the performance of these different stores and allows you to choose a store that might fit your needs. Or if you don't want to crawl, there's also a shortcut. People are crawling for you. So there is a billion triple data set. At the Semantic Web Conference, there's since years the Semantic Web Challenge, where cool applications are showcased. And for this challenge, since 3 years now, I think, Andreas Hart von Kit crawls the web of data, or at least the parts that his crawler gets. This year, he has crawled 2 billion triples, which is around 20 gigabyte gzipped. The data is relatively recent, from June 2011, and can be downloaded from this page. So if you want to experiment with bigger amounts of data, don't want to crawl, use this data. If your experiments lead to any good results, submit the results at the Billion Triple Challenge. Deadline is October 1st, and yeah, classically, at least last year, it was two tracks in the Semantic Web Challenge, one for applications in general, and one where people need to use this, this large amount of data, and currently still lots of people are scared away by this 2 billion triples. So in the last years, there were much more submissions in the open track where you can submit whatever you like. That uses some data, uses some reasoning and stuff, but yeah, like this year, I hope that more people take up the challenge and implement applications really based on this large amounts of public data that we currently have on the web. Yeah, maybe I use my last 5 minutes for the last topic, splitting the data integration effort. What I think, what also distinguishes linked data from other data integration architectures like federated querying or data warehouses, is that all data is put in one global data space, but you can also put integration knowledge into the same data space. So people who spend effort on figuring out how the schemata of two data sources match can publish the results of this integration effort to the web so that other people can use them. So basically, the data integration effort can be split between consumers of the data, third parties, and also the publishers can take part in the integration effort by following some standards. So how does it work? Publish identity links on the web. Identity link, you do use a tool like Silk to find out that two URIs in two databases refer to the same thing. You can publish the result as an identity link, as an OWL same as link, saying that you think that this URI identifying person 4 is about the same person as this other URI, identifying somebody called Chris Blitzer. If you publish this on the web, other people can use it. You can publish this, or if you are too lazy, you just put your data source online and somebody else thinks your data source is interesting, goes through the effort of finding these links, the other person can also publish the links on the web. If I look at this process from the effort perspective, I see that the effort is kind of split between publishers and third parties who provide these links and the consumer. The more links the publisher or third parties provide, the easier the job becomes for the data consumer. But still, if they don't provide links, the consumer can still use data mining techniques or tools like Silk to create the links on the client side. The same applies to vocabularies. As in theory, you can use any vocabulary you like to publish data on the web of data. But if you as a data publisher want to be nice, you go through the effort to find out what the common vocabularies in your domain are and publish data using these vocabularies. So there's a bunch of vocabularies that are currently widely used. Shock, FOV, SCOS, good relations, music ontology, review ontology. You can use these vocabularies. Many data sources decide to use these vocabularies for parts of their data. For other more specific parts, they still use proprietary vocabularies because these vocabularies are rather generic. The more effort the publisher puts into reusing these vocabularies, the easier it becomes, of course, for the data consumer to integrate data from lots of sources. Or also, same effect as with the links, you can also publish vocabulary links, meaning one data source uses a proprietary term, you do manual schema mapping or mine some mappings, find out that this term in one vocabulary refers to the other term in another vocabulary. You can publish this finding of your data integration effort as a vocabulary link, an equivalent class link on the web. or as a subclass link, equivalent property link, or you can also use this language R2R to express, publish more complex mappings on the web. So again, data effort is split. The more effort publishers put in reusing vocabularies, the easier it becomes to use the data. The more effort publisher put into mappings, the easier it becomes to use the data. Still, just having access to the data is good for the data consumer, because the more data he has, the easier it becomes for him to use data mining techniques to find out what the vocabulary mappings actually are. So example, Google Base. Google Base allows you to put data in using any schemata, and then later, as they just have so much instance data, it becomes easy for them to mine mappings between the different schematas from the data just by looking at the instances, and then translate the data to their target schemata that they use in applications. So this is possible, but publishers and third party can make the integration task easier. Genau, so if you want a nice term for this, you can call it somebody pays as you go. So if you are lucky, somebody else already has published the integration information that you need on the web and you can reuse it. So conclusion, web of data is growing rapidly. There are active deployment communities in different domains. Open source tool landscape is improving. There are tools available for most all relevant tasks in the linked data consumption workflow. And yeah, what I like, identity and vocabulary links ease the data integration compared to other architectures like data warehouses. Yes, this was it. Part of the work presented in this talk was funded, the work on tools was funded by an EU project called LOT2. I think in the next talk, also people from this project will present stuff. And yes, here are some references to things about linked data. There's a textbook about linked data now, which also contains additional information about all the tools that I've mentioned, and which is also available for free on the web at linkdatabook.com. Thank you.